Chair recognizes Mr. Vitolo. Mr. Vitolo of Brookline.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. I am honored to deliver my inaugural speech today on such an important piece of legislation. And while I am saddened that I won't receive 159 handshakes and hugs from my colleagues today, I look forward to a future day when the sky is clearer, the grass is greener, and we can gather together to celebrate this landmark bill. This year has put a magnifying glass on the great divide between rich and poor, black and white, rural and urban, and I am grateful, Mr. Speaker, for your hard work to bring this bill to the floor before the conclusion of this session and for ensuring that those divisions are addressed in this bill. Thank you to your predecessor, the gentleperson from Winthrop, whose dedication to taking dramatic action on climate change has culminated in this piece of legislation. Thank you to the members of the conference committee, the gentlepersons from Lowell, Somerset, North Reading, and from the Senate, from Lexington, Newton, and Weymouth, whose work over these past few months has brought forward this comprehensive bill. A special thank you to the gentleman from Lowell, whose leadership on climate will now put the Commonwealth on the leading edge of this fight against climate change, and who took all my good lines just before I used them. Thank you to staff, and thank you to all of the advocates who have worked on various bits and pieces over the past 2 years and more, and who I know will keep working today and tomorrow to make sure that this bill is signed into law. Thank you to my friends, neighbors, and so many who helped me earn the trust of the residents of Brookline. I work hard every day to strengthen our bond. I want to thank my parents who have supported me for all my years. Your support has not been because of my interests, my passion, or my politics. To be frank, it has been in spite of those things, me being the lone donkey in a herd of Vitolo elephants. Thank you to my children, Felice and Angelina. I am sorry that this came up on a school day, but at this point, any day of in-person learning is more important than whatever Daddy is rambling on about. Thank you to my wife, Jennifer. I loved you more than I had ever known the first time I laid eyes on you on November 15th, 1999. And I love you more and more each day since. Nobody in this legislature needs to be reminded about the science or the risks of climate change, its man-made causes, the damage to our ecosystems, the way it will impoverish and physically harm people across the globe, most acutely those who are already struggling. Climate change will impose harm on every single one of us. It is therefore appropriate that so many in our legislature played important roles in putting together this ambitious, achievable bill. The gentleperson from Hull certainly knows the dangers of rising seas and increased storms. Her roadmap to a solution, it's in the bill, targets every 5 years, including a 50% reduction from 1990 levels by 2030, 75% by 2040, and net zero by 2050. The gentleperson from Duxbury also acutely knows of the coastal impacts on climate. His work on energy efficiency is in this bill. And because of that work, people across the Commonwealth will soon purchase appliances that use less energy and therefore save all of us some money on electric, oil, gas, and water bills. It will also help us reclaim our number one spot on the AC EEE scorecard, a position we were just knocked out of a few weeks ago for the first time in many years. The science on emissions reductions isn't lost on the gentleperson from Cambridge. Her work on increasing the renewable portfolio standard is in this bill too. And as a result, each of us who has electric service from Eversource, National Grid, or Unitil We'll have electricity that is even cleaner than it would have been, thanks to the 5 percentage point increase in the RPS from 2025 to 2029. If anyone knows about retooling for a 21st century industry, it's the gentle person from Somerset. Her work on offshore wind has been dogged, and our offshore wind tranche grows from 1,600 megawatts to 4,000 megawatts in this bill, with the process accelerated from a 24-month window to 18. As a wind turbine once said, I'm a big fan. Workforce development isn't just about a single industry within energy. We've got to make sure that a just and equitable transition includes workers across the energy economy. The gentle person from Holliston, acutely aware of this detail, called for the creation of a workforce development within MassCEC. We will rely on tens of thousands of green-collar workers, both blue-green and whitish-green, to help us get to a net zero 2050. And each of those workers must have the skills, knowledge, and tools to help bring us there. It's in the bill. The mission of the Department of Public Utilities is an important piece of bureaucratic infrastructure, and that wasn't lost on the gentle person from Marblehead. Her work in requiring that the DPU balance priorities, including system safety, system security, reliability, affordability, equity, and greenhouse gas emissions reductions, represent an important pivot in the natural gas distribution industry, and it's in the bill. Some communities want to push forward on climate initiatives faster than others. One such community is Brookline, whose Warrant Article 21, calling for restrictions on fossil fuel piping in new construction, passed its representative town meeting 211-3. The Attorney General ruled that the proposed bylaw ran afoul of MGL, upon which the gentle person from Newton, Lower Falls, and I filed an amendment on July 30th, calling for municipal opt-in of a more ambitious appendix to the building code to be crafted by DOER in consultation with the BBRS. July 2020 was too soon, but January 2021 is not. This bill contains language to allow communities to opt into a net zero stretch code, just as communities have been able to opt in to the stretch energy code for over a decade. Thank you to my friend from Newton Lower Falls for working with me on this piece. It's not all electrons and methane molecules. The gentle persons from North Reading and Provincetown understand this, and that's why they've been working on how our natural and working lands can be a bigger part of the solution. This bill requires a study so that we can understand just that, ensuring that our natural resources aren't just protected, but embraced as we combat the climate crisis. And as important as our ecosystems are in the Commonwealth, I believe our people are even more important. That's why I'm so pleased that the work on environmental justice by the gentle persons from East Boston, Roxbury, and Brockton is included. Social and economic justice is so important to me, and environmental justice is a critical component. This bill includes the EJ provisions that this body included in July, because we understand that we must ensure we're elevating the voices of those who are choking on tailpipe emissions, downwind from the smokestacks, most at risk to the dangers of our decisions on development and infrastructure. To get the better of climate change, we must all work together. I believe this bill serves as a model for other legislative bodies, not just on what components are necessary to drive emissions to net zero by 2050, but in how to bring so many people together in proposing a solution. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, for ensuring of that. And thank you to each and every member of the House and Senate who has leaned in, whispered, cajoled, encouraged, or otherwise helped to bring this critical bill to the floor for our vote today. I hope my colleagues will join me in voting in favor of this legislation. Thank you.